It's good to see you all here. What a beautiful morning, isn't it? What a start to Easter week. We're really excited about this whole build-up to Easter. You know, we call it the greatest day in history, and it really is. And so, welcome to First Presbyterian Church. If you're here in person, if you're watching online, you're all part of our worship here, and we're excited to start celebrating. And we celebrate because we know the victory's already won. Isn't that right? You know, we have all the sadness of Holy Week and what led up to that horrific time that Jesus went through. But we're focused on that. But the thing that we're really focused on is next Sunday, that Jesus is risen. And we're excited about that. We're excited that Jesus is alive. And we want to invite you to come. We want to invite you to be with us, either online, but we would love to see you in person. Here in church, we have our three services at 8:15, this one at 9, and then 10:30. And we would love you to join us as we celebrate the risen Savior. We're going to be doing the flooring of the cross next Sunday. I was going to say next year, but we didn't get it done last year, but we're going to do it this year. And that's tremendous. It's been done here for many years. And we make the black cross, as such, come alive with new life. And please come. We would love to see you here. As we go through this week, let us reflect on what Jesus was willing to do for each one of us. It's humbling, isn't it? It's humbling to know that Jesus would give everything for you and for me. And what do we give him in return? Only we can answer that. So thank you for being here. Thank you for Deanne for joining us. I'm going to be talking to Deanne later on. She's going to share some stuff with us. And we're looking forward to hearing it. And we're so blessed that you're with us again and feeling great. And she'll tell you all about that story. Today we're talking about being prepared. How prepared are we for the coming of Jesus? This day, 2,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago, people rejoiced that the king was coming. And a few days later, they cried, "Crucify." How do we welcome him this week? How do we welcome him today? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that we can come at the start of this Holy Week, here on Palm Sunday, and we lift our hearts and our voices to you. We sing your praises and we shout, "Hosanna. Hosanna, the King is coming." And Lord, we look forward to next Sunday. We look forward to the victory of the cross and the resurrection. We ask you to bless us, to challenge us, and to take us to the place that you want us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand as we worship and we sing our hosannas. This is Praise is Rising. Praise Funny that we sing, you know, we welcome you here, and it's his place, it's his home, and he's welcome here, and he would say we're welcome here. And as we worship together, we're just lifting our praises to the one who deserves all praises. This is a new one we did a few weeks ago, where it's called Graves in the Gardens. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. No, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. God of the mountain. He's the God of the valley. There's not a place where your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There is nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn grave into gardens. You turn bones into army. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's Easter. You know, he changes graves into gardens. He makes everything beautiful. Have a seat. I'm going to ask Deanne to come up and join us. We're going to stay down here. Oh, look how much. She has so many notes with her. It's unbelievable. She has two words down here. You have to keep that up close there.
Oh, yeah. They don't need.
You have to eat it like a lollipop.
Wait, before you start. Those of you who do know me know I usually sit up there, and I don't get to see that. Is that not gorgeous with the sun coming through there? Sorry. It's so pretty.
I thought you meant when you were sitting down there and you could look up at me and
oh,
you thought, isn't that so gorgeous?
Isn't that, yeah. Sorry, that outshines you.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. She's going for her eye test next week, so it's all right. Deanne, it's great having you here.
Thank you.
There's been some things going on in your life that you weren't really prepared for.
Yeah, like a secret.
Yeah, could you tell us a little story?
I would be very glad to tell you the greatest God story I've ever had in my entire life. And on his Lenten series, he's used a lot of P words. The ones that stick out to me right now with what I'm going to tell you is the purpose, prayer, last week's proclaim. I almost stood up last week and told this story. And then the prepare today, because there's no way you can be prepared for this. What happened to me was December the 15th. Oh, I should preface this by saying I'm a really healthy person. I walk every day. I've walked every day for 23 years. I eat really well. I don't have high cholesterol. I don't have diabetes. I don't have, not overweight, all those things, okay? So anyway, I get up really early so I can get these walks in every day before I go to work. And on December the 15th, I was up having my breakfast, and I had a really weird pain right in the middle of my chest. And it went clear to my back. And I was like, this is a little weird. And so I got up and walked around, you know, like, oh, I can just make it go away. And the other thing is I have a tile floor in my kitchen breakfast nook area, and it was cold because it was December. I thought, oh, I'll just lay down on the floor. You know how sometimes that'll solve things? So I laid on the floor, and it was, like, still there, and I got up, and then I felt the pain go down my arm. And all of us know that that's not a good thing. So I went and woke up Chris, and I said, something really weird's going on. I think we need to go to the ER. And so he got up, and he'll laugh. He'll tell you this later. He got up and brushed his teeth and got ready. And he said, I can't believe I stopped and brushed my teeth. But anyway, we laugh about that now because we can. Anyway, so off we went. I went and got my coat, got my car keys. I text my boss, having some weird chest pains, might be late. So when we're on our way and it's like 5:20, I'm telling you, I get up early. And so it's the blinking red lights. And Chris looked at me and he said, do I need to run these? And I said, well, they're the blinking red lights. I said, just make sure no one's coming. But yes, you need to hurry. So anyway, we got to the ER, and this is in the middle of the worst of COVID. And so like even getting in the ER is a trip. And so I went in there and like there's the thing you're supposed to test your temperature. But I just walked right in and I'm like, oh, look, I'm having chest pains. Something weird's going on. She said, okay. And she just sat me down. And so Chris walked in then and they came out with the wheelchair and I handed him my purse and they took me back there. Okay, so I get into the room and she said, okay, here's the gown, put the gown on. I did that laying down on the bed and coded. Really? And so I'm waking up after it happened, and in my head I'm thinking, why was I so tired? I just got up. Anyway, and they're putting an oxygen mask on me, and this lady's tapping my shoulder saying, okay, Deanne, stay with us, stay with us. And I'm like, I'm looking at him, and this guy, there's like 18 people in there, and he said, well, you had a heart attack. And I said, what? That was my word all day long. Because then someone else said, well, yeah, we had to shock your heart. What? And then I'm having this horrendous pain. Not the heart pain, but like pain. And the lady said, well, you probably have cracked ribs from the compressions. And I was like, what? And she said, yeah, that's a really good thing. That means we did it right. And so I'm like, I'm telling you, I'm in shock. And I'm still struggling with that part as I relive it. Anyway, they said, yeah, we're gonna, the doctor's on his way, we're gonna take you down, they're gonna put a stent in. What? I'm serious, I just kept saying that, and the doctor comes in, and I looked at him, and I go, I am the healthiest person I know. I don't have anything wrong with me, I don't have high cholesterol, I don't have any of that stuff, and he goes, sometimes it's just bad luck. I'm like, okay. So anyway, so they took me down, I had 100% blocked LAD artery, and for any of you in the medical field, know that's the widowmaker that we found out later. Anyway, they go down, they put the stent in. An hour after I got to the ER, I was back in the room, felt great. And seriously, that's all it was. I mean, I still struggle with what happened to me because of, my good health and all that. Anyway, and so I was in the ICU, which is where they would put you, and they said, yeah, we're just going to keep you here. I had wonderful care, wonderful new. They've redone the ICU at the hospital. It's really nice. It was like a suite. Anyway, about 5:30 that day, remember, this is in the middle of the bad COVID. They came in with the wheelchair, and they said, yeah, we're going to move you to a room. And I said, okay, why? And they said, because there are people in the waiting room waiting to get in. If I would have had to wait to get in, I would have died. There's just lots of little, hear the God story in all of this. So I go to my room, and everything was good. I mean, I stayed there for 2 days. I left that was December 15th. I left December 17th with a life vest on, which is a wearable defibrillator. Another horrible situation. Anyway, that was a long 3 months. But before I left the hospital, I have to add one more God story to this. I wasn't on any medication. And they came in. I have hospital insurance, and so I have wonderful people that were helping me with all these things. And they came. The lady from the pharmacy came up and talked to me. I had this list of 6 medications I was going to have to take. Now, with the hospital insurance, we only have to pay a copay if it's a generic medicine. 2 of the medicines on here did not have a generic thing, and they were like over $400 a month. And so Chris and I were like, okay, shock. We're still in shock. We have to take all this. And we were sitting there, and Chris goes, and I truly believe God was telling him this. He said, Deanne, I'm going to take that list down, and I'm going to talk to Dr. Hagley. And you never get to see Dr. Hagley because he's a busy, busy man. Chris went down there, walked into their office, and Dr. Hagley walked out of his room. Chris goes, Chris showed him that list, and he said, oh, she doesn't need to be on this and this. He took 2 of them off. One of them was the expensive one. And the other one, he said, she really needs to be on that for like a month, and then I can change it around. So Chris comes back upstairs, it's all cool. So the lady at the pharmacy that we always work with, we love her, her name is Stephanie. I called, the lady said, well, call Stephanie and she might be able to help you or whatever.
So I called her and she said, Deanne, we're going to find a coupon for you. She actually got online, told me where to call. I called this place, got a coupon. That $400 a month medicine, she got down to $25 a month. I recently got the refill for it. She got it down $5 for the whole 3 months. I mean, you know, it's just God played a part in this whole thing. When I left that Thursday with that life vest that I, sorry, that was just a long 3 months. He told me, you have to wear this. This is for whenever, if you were ever alone and you passed out and your heart went into AFib, it would shock your heart back into rhythm. And you have to wear it or we're going to put in a permanent defibrillator. I was like, okay. And at the 3 months, you'll have a new echocardiogram and then we'll decide how you're doing. You either go on or we'll take it off and you go on or you will have to put in this permanent defibrillator. So on March 15th, 3 months to the day, I had the echocardiogram. That's when I asked for prayers, and I know there was a bunch of you out here that helped me with the prayers that day. I had the echocardiogram, and the next day I saw the doctor, and he told me my heart was completely back to normal. Okay, go back 3 months to that day when he was there, guided us to the hospital. I got there just in time so that, like, when I had my heart attack, I was already on the table dressed ready for them to fix me. So very little time happened. I truly believe that because of that is why my heart's completely back to normal. Because I didn't have a heart attack for like a half an hour and lay on the floor somewhere. It was all because he guided us through the entire thing. I will say this till the day I die, which is tomorrow or 100 years from now. But he guided us through this whole thing. Purpose, I have one somewhere.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out. Prayer got us through the whole thing, still gets us through everything. But I cannot thank everyone enough for the prayers through all of this. Never would have made it without it. And so the prepared, no, you'll never be prepared. But if you got him there, you can be prepared and take. Anyway, and so the proclaim from last week, I'll proclaim it forever. He was with us. And if I can share one little thing. I only have 5 minutes. I don't want to go over.
It's now 25. What's up?
Okay. So this is something that's unbelievable in this story. I get Christmas letters from Tim and Debbie Soule. You know, I used to sing with them. And so we've kept in touch. This was at the end of their Christmas letter 2 years ago, and I cut it out that day. It's on my computer. I end all my prayers with this, and I have it on my computer at work for when I need to see it. But listen to the words after this little story. As a faithful people, remember, wherever you go, God has a plan for you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. God has a purpose in you being there. The one who indwells you has something for you to do where you are. Believe this and go in God's grace, love, and power, and the blessing of God be with you today and always. She said he shared that during the Christmas season at the end of all his services, but I start and end every day with this. So.
Wonderful.
Yeah. So I feel great. It's way good to be here.
It's good to have you here.
In a small corner of the city, a parade began. No internet, no announcements, no tweets. Word of mouth carried the news. And the parade had no floats, no balloons, no bands. Just the voices of the people singing one word. Hosanna. The word has no actual meaning. It'd be like trying to define the word hooray. But still, they knew what it meant. Hosanna, the king has arrived. Jesus had been working quietly behind the scenes, urging people to not tell of what they saw. But how can you keep a secret like that? They were ready for him. They had been praying for his arrival for generations. The Messiah had come. Hosanna. They waved branches. They threw their coats on the road. It was all they could do. They gave him a breeze and they sang him a song. Hosanna. It was all they had. They would die for him. But what they didn't understand is that it was going to happen the other way around. The Pharisees were watching, waiting. Planning. He was too popular. The crowds would follow him anywhere. even if you silence the crowd, you can't silence creation. Even if you silence the crowd, the rocks would sing, the trees would take up chorus, and the earth itself would sing, Hosanna. Hosanna, the King has arrived.
The King has arrived. What a message. I want to read to you from John 12, verses 12 to 17. This is Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. The next day, the great crowd had come for the festival, heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. And they took the palm branches and they went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it as it is written, Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. At first, the disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him, that these things had been done to him. Now, the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Jesus, the King, is coming. We're in week four of our season and our sermon series on Lent. So far, as Deanne had said, we focused on purpose and prayer and proclaim, and today is prepare. The question for all of us today is, are we prepared to carry on the mission of Jesus? Are we willing to carry on the mission of Jesus? John the Baptist was sent to prepare the way for the coming Messiah. He preached repentance, and he prepared the people to meet the Savior. That was John's role. He knew his purpose. He was preparing the way. And all of Jesus' life and ministry was preparing him for the events that would happen on this horrific yet victorious week. All the stuff that was going to happen in Jerusalem, Jesus was prepared for what was coming. Jesus did not come to Jerusalem by chance. It wasn't a last minute thought. Let's go to Jerusalem. There's going to be a party there. Everybody's going to be there. There was a reason for Jesus to be there. He was going for a purpose, and he was prepared to do whatever it took. He came to fulfill God's plan. And that was the plan of salvation for you, for me, and for all of mankind. He was prepared for the adulation. Can you just imagine it? Can you imagine as he come into Jerusalem, the noise and the cheers and the hosannas, the excitement at that entry into Jerusalem? And yet in the back of his mind, he was prepared for what he knew was to come. As Deanne said, you can't prepare yourself for some of the things that are going to happen to us in life. But when we have Jesus on our side, that's all we need. He gives us the assurance and the peace and the blessings. Unfortunately, the people that cheered and waved their palms and got so excited as they placed him on the ground before him, were not really prepared to meet the Messiah. They had missed the point. They didn't realize what was happening. They'd missed the purpose. They wanted a conquering king to arrive. They expected him to come on the big white horse. But he came on a donkey. The conquering king came on a donkey because that's not what he was coming to be. He was coming to be their redeemer. He was coming to be their redeemer, not their warrior king. They were looking for something different. And I want to ask us this morning, what are we looking for this Easter? What is God preparing for us? Because God is always preparing things for us. We just be blinded so many times because we have our own agenda with our own things that we want to do. But God is preparing us for more than we can ever imagine. Matthew 5:16 tells us that we are to let our light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. He's preparing us to shine. We look out the windows today. We come in here this morning. The sun is shining. You know, the Son of God is always shining. And he's looking us to reflect his glory and who he is to the world today. Does our world need lit up with the light and the love of Jesus? You're right, it does. We're looking for solutions in all these different places when we need to look to the sun. We need to shine bright. That's what God wants us to do. I love that. I love that fact that God wants us to radiate him, to have a radiance from us, that when others see us, they know there's something different. And not weird different, but something wonderful, something that draws people to ask, what is it? What is it that makes the difference? And we know it's Jesus. We're to light up a way that people can see God. He's actually calling each of us to be John the Baptist, to prepare the way for the people. Good news, he doesn't want us to dress funny. He doesn't want us to put on all the hurry cloth and eat locusts like John the Baptist did. But he wants us to have that heart of John the Baptist that prepares the way for the coming king. And he just doesn't want us to be John the Baptist at Easter. He wants us to be it 365 days a year. We are preparing a way that people can see the King of Kings. You see, John the Baptist is gone. He's long gone. Jesus is also gone to be in heaven, where he's reigning with the Father. So who's going to take his place? Do you ever think of that? John the Baptist is gone, preparing the way. Jesus has gone back to heaven. He called his disciples to go. They're long gone. So who's left? It's you. It's me. We are to step up. It's time for us to step up. Great here, Deanne saying, you know, I'm going to proclaim this till the day I die. And I loved her optimism when she said, and that might be in 100 years from now. You know, could well be. Who would know? But you know, we want to proclaim Jesus. We have to proclaim him. This is our purpose. It was his purpose. That's why he came to Jerusalem. There was a purpose to him coming. The way was prepared for this time. And we are to share the hope that is found only in Jesus Christ. On that Palm Sunday in Jerusalem, the crowds had a new hope. But unfortunately for them, it was a false hope because they believed that he was coming to release them from the Roman Empire. That was not the case. So they were rejoicing, but it was a false rejoicing because it wasn't him coming to do what they wanted, but him coming to do what they really needed. They needed a Savior. Jesus was not coming to destroy and rise up against the Romans. No, he was coming to destroy the chains of sin and pay the price for sin, for the mistakes that we make, for the sinful nature. He was coming to set everyone free. What a message, to be free from the shackles of sin, to be free to know that we are forgiven when we turn to Jesus Christ. We are to prepare people to hear the good news of the gospel. Listen to these words from 2 Corinthians 3:2. This is the Message version. You yourselves are all the endorsement we need. Your very lives are a letter that anyone can read by just looking at you. Christ himself wrote it, not with ink, but with God's living spirit. Not chiseled into stone, but carved into human lives. And we publish it. I love that version. It's just such a great picture. It really challenges me. And I asked myself this question during the week, and I'm asking it to you today. What do people read when they look at my life? What do people read when they look at your life? What's the story being told? What is the story that God is putting into our hearts and our lives for others to see? Let's stop for a moment and let that sink in. Ask yourself, what do people see in me? Is it Jesus? I know you've heard it said that you may be the only Bible that some people will read, and it's so true. So the thing that we have to ask is, are we a good version of that Bible? Are we translated well in today's world to show Jesus? Are we? Only you can answer that. Only I can answer that. But as Jesus entered Jerusalem with a purpose to fulfill salvation for an unprepared people, he didn't ride through that street, and as they shouted Hosanna, he didn't tell them, shh, you've got this wrong. Because he knew they'd got it wrong. He knew what was coming. God is calling us to be prepared to share the saving grace with everyone who doesn't know him. But how are they going to know if we don't tell them? If we're happy to stay within our church buildings and we talk about Jesus on a Sunday, how are people going to know? Someone has to do it. Someone has to prepare the way. And my friends, as uncomfortable as this may make you feel, you're it. You're it. God is preparing you for something. The aunt said, I don't know what he's preparing me for yet. But she does know, because it's to proclaim Jesus. So, where are we standing this Palm Sunday? Are we with that crowd that's cheering for Jesus and have just missed the point? Are we with the others who hated Jesus? We heard about the Pharisees. People were plotting what was going to happen to Jesus as he arrived to that fanfare. People hated Jesus. They would have crucified him then and there if possible. So which crowd are we listening to? And I can hear you say, what a stupid question, Keith. We're all here. We would never have deserted Jesus. If you'd have done a poll, an exit poll, of all the people who were in Jerusalem cheering him on, they would have said, we will never desert Jesus. He's our king. We are here. We believe. That was what the majority of the crowd thought. But quickly, within hours really, they had changed. Because Jesus hadn't given them what they hoped for. They wanted something from Jesus that he wasn't there to give them. He was there to give them something greater, and they couldn't see it because their minds were so consumed with what they thought their need was, when Jesus knew what their real need was: forgiveness, salvation, freedom from sin. The noise of the world can drown out God's word if we're not committed to it. We need to start listening. My friends, God is preparing a kingdom for all of us who love him and follow him. God is doing a work in each of us that we have to start to recognize. Whatever you've been waiting on God to do, do you really expect him to do it? You know, many of us say, I'm waiting to hear what God's going to say to me. One of the last churches that I was in, I would have heard this from Christians who were, I looked up to and thought, wow, you know so much about God's word. You know so much about the Bible that you could share. And when you asked them to go out and share it, they said, we're not ready yet. I asked them how long is it going to take, because they'd been absorbed in the word of God for 40 odd years, 50 years, 60 years. But we're not ready yet. We're not prepared. My friends, we're never going to be prepared unless we put our trust in Jesus Christ. Because he gives us the strength. It is his Holy Spirit that takes us out to make the difference, to put the words into our mouth. A lot of times we think we're waiting on God, but I firmly believe that God's actually waiting on us. He's waiting on us to put our hand up and say, I'm ready. Yo-ho, I'm ready. And once we do that, God is there. God's going to give us what we need. He's waiting on us. Maybe saying, you've grown up now. It's time to go out into the big world and make a difference. You're not waiting on me. I'm waiting on you to say yes, to say, send me. Here I am. I want you to be prepared. I want all of us to be prepared for the journey ahead. And to do that, we're going to need to get still before God. We need to get into his word. We need to learn to be more like him. Then we can get busy doing the work that he has prepared for us. Palm Sunday leads us to Good Friday, to the cross, and then to the empty tomb and the risen Jesus. Always have found it strange that we call the most horrific death for the Son of God Good Friday. It was anything but good. But there was a purpose behind it. That's why it was good. Because without the cross, there would not have been the resurrection. Because it leads to the resurrection morning of Easter Sunday, when victory over death and sin was completed. Jesus became the final and complete sacrifice for our sins. We cannot erase our guilt. We cannot overcome our sins by our good deeds. So many people think if we work hard enough and we do nice things, we're going to be okay. God's going to pat you on the back and say, well done. He's going to say, who are you? If you don't know him, if you haven't given your life to him. Jesus died for us on that first Good Friday to prepare us for heaven, to prepare us to share and to show the way. So today, as we celebrate Jesus' arrival, as he played out those final scenes in God's salvation plan, let us grasp the need for each of us to experience a Good Friday, to experience death to ourselves, and to rise again with Jesus in complete control of our lives. When we confess our sins, when we put our faith and our trust in Christ. So here's what we're going to do to finish. I'm going to make you get up and I'm going to make you walk. And if you're over on this side, you're going to get plenty of steps in. If you're Fitbit, get it ready, because you're going to get some steps in. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to walk out the door and don't leave. Come round and come down this aisle. There's a table here with a lot of palms on it. So I'm going to move, and the cameras will be going, what? Where was he going? But I'm down here. I want you to take a palm. I want you to take a palm leaf, and I want you to walk across, and I want you just to place it at the foot of the cross. Because this is a journey. There's a path. Palm Sunday is a road that leads us to the cross. And next Sunday, we're going to have that cross come alive with the most beautiful flowers and color to say that Jesus has risen. But as you come forward and as you pick up your palm, I And as you walk across here, and you don't have to set them all around, you can make a bit of a pathway, you can do whatever you want. And then if you go back this way or that way, we're not going to have a traffic jam, hopefully. But I want you to take that palm, and as you walk across, I want you to think. I want you to think about the journey that you're on this Easter. What is God preparing for you? What's Easter going to mean to you? What's Easter Sunday going to look like for you? Because he has something special for us. And I hope and pray that this week, that each of us will make our way to the cross, where we will find hope, love, forgiveness, and freedom. I believe more than ever that God is preparing us for a freedom journey that we can share with others and release them and set them free. And I want to end with John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Go home and read that. Read that every day this week. John 3:16-17. God did not come to condemn us. He came to set us free. He's preparing us for something greater than we can imagine. He's preparing this church for something greater than any of us can imagine. He has been preparing the way, and we have been blessed. We have been blessed. We are blessed that Deanne is doing so well. We've been praying for others. We've been praying for our friend Big Jimmy that always helped us in our sound booth, who is now doing so well after open heart surgery. God is good. God is preparing us for something greater. This week, really focus on what that is. And remember that God loved you so much that he was willing to give his Son for you. Not because he had nothing else to do. Not because this was just something nice to do, but he was doing this because he was preparing you and me for something great. So, we're going to sing our last song, and it'll be up on the screens, and you can sing as you're walking. That's what the crowds would have done. We're not singing a joyous song, but we're singing a song of hope, and of how we can turn to Jesus for everything. So we're going to start, and we're going to move, pick up, lift, sit, come back, and we'll just keep praising. Does that make sense? As an Irishman, I'm not good in direction, so I'm not going to tell you need to go north, south, east, or west. Just turn around, go out the door, come down here. That's the way we do things in Ireland, all right? But just make your way to the front.
My cause, you right my wrongs, you break my chains, you overcome, you give your life. inside, I doubt that you could love me. But in your eyes, there's only grace now. You plead my cause.
Break my chains, you overcome. You give your life to give me mine. You say that I am free. And we say, yes, we are when we turn to you. And this week, make that our prayer. To realize that we are set free. To realize that there's more to life than what the world tells us. There's a freedom that comes in Jesus Christ. And let's come together next Sunday. Let's invite others to come with us. Let's fill this place with praises. And our theme next week is praise. We're praising a risen Savior. Come and join us. Join us online, but join us in person, because we want to share the greatest message and the greatest day in history with everyone who wants to hear it. Have a blessed and a time of freedom. God bless.